we hope. And I just wanted to start by saying there's a question that Hannah Arendt once asked that I often refer to, which is the question, where are we when we think? And I think tonight's event really is about that we offer quite a number of programs here at the Contemporary that look at a number of different kinds of issues, but we don't often reflect on the conditions in which we all work in this field. And on the sort of eve of May Day, in the city where Chartism and Ludditism were kind of invented, or at least became an epicenter or a focus, it's really quite great to have this kind of global and local perspective on workers' rights in the arts. And I just wanted to say that this event is also a little bit in an intersection with tomorrow night's event, which is looking at questions of race and colonialism in the art school and the art gallery system. And I think we can never think these questions of labor without thinking of questions of race and racism. So I'm hoping that where possible, people will come tonight and tomorrow night, and we have some of the speakers from tomorrow night here with us this evening. So I'm going to just say thank you to our collaborators at Loughborough University who have enabled us to create this amazing series on art and activism and critical citizenship. Over to Gillian.
Thanks, George. And some thanks. My name's Gillian Whiteley, and I'm the Politicized group at the School of the Arts, Loughborough University. And it's great, really, that Nottingham Contemporary and Jana and everybody and the technical staff and everybody here has enabled this this event, which I think is really, really fantastic that it's come together. And in fact, it's the third event in our series, which I'm just going to just say a little bit about this, that's all, the Critical Citizenship Activism Art Series, which is a joint project between ourselves, the Politicized Practice Research Group, and the Anarchist Research Group at Loughborough University. It's the third event in the series, and we set this kind of series and the set of events up around the idea of alternative forms of grassroots, direct action, what might an alternative form of citizenship be, really. And we were looking at the intersection between activism and art and hopefully entering and engaging with those debates and hopefully provoking some other thoughts around those themes. As I say, it's the third one in the series. The first one we had at Loughborough University, which was the Interference Archive from New York. People came and talked about that grassroots archive, which was great. And we had one here in February, which was Liberate Tate, Art Not Oil. And then next week, I've left some leaflets outside if anyone's able to come, it's at Loughborough University for the fourth one, which will be on DIY publishing and zines. So please come along to that. And I think tonight's topic, which I really want to say, just to say that this is it's such a really important topic, I think. Obviously, I teach in a School of the Arts with arts undergraduates, and I think that some of the issues around working conditions for young people in the creative industries, and particularly for young people trying to find a way to work in that kind of way, issues around unpaid work, you know, 0 hours contracts, precarious working conditions in our art institutions and cultural sector, it's just completely endemic, and it's really great that we're able to address some of these issues, I think, through some of these campaigning bodies and organisations that we're going to hear tonight, and it's really good that we've got them together, and I want to thank Aria for doing this, and Vlad for putting this together. So I'll hand over. Thanks.
Great. Hello, everyone. It's great that you managed to come out, and I'm really, really happy to be the organizer of this event, and I wanted to thank everybody for coming. I wanted to thank all our speakers for participating, even from Los Angeles and New York, and I also wanted to thank Vlad, who has been working with me on this event, as well as the Politicized Practice Research Group and Anarchist Research Group. The question of bringing together all these different groups actually came out of a discussion that I had last year with Annie Shaw, who is part of the Intern Labor Rights, which is an arts advocacy group which was based in New York, and it stemmed out from the Occupy Arts and Labor. And it was looking, the discussion was around how the strategies and different tactics were similar and which were the contents to different groups that were working in different countries. So finally, after a year's time, we managed to give a platform to this sort of cross-cultural way of understanding art and activism. And I'm really, before we start, I really want you to, first of all, engage with everybody in the sense that these are groups that are really talking about artists' rights for everybody. So please get in contact with them. Precarious Workers Brigade are here. So if you have the chance to talk to them after the event, that would be great. The conversation that we're going to have after these presentations actually involves also Artists Union, and I invited Rachel Perry, who's right there, and most of you know her because she's based here. But the discussion will continue also with their contribution to thinking about strategies and thinking about different ways of organizing activism. But there are two points that I really think are important to underline. One is the fact that these groups really have a direct relation, in the case of intern labor rights, to larger social movements, and in the case of WAG.E and also of intern labor rights, it's Occupy Wall Street, and in the case of Precarious Workers Brigade, it was the student movements in 2010. And also, I think that this precondition to understanding their work is pushing towards a new theoretical framework that we should take into consideration. And within that theoretical framework, there are two really important issues that we should look at. And one is consciousness raising, and the other one is ethics. So I will probably continue this discussion through a few questions that I'll have for all three groups. And I just wanted to tell you how it's going to work out. It's kind of really, really packed, so bear with us. I've asked all three groups to do 15-minute presentations, after which we can maybe squeeze in a question, one question, to each. We're going to start with Annie Shaw from Los Angeles, who is part of Intern Labor Rights, and then WAG.E with Lee Sosconi, and then we have Marsha, Vera, and Tatiana from Precarious Workers Brigade. Afterwards, we'll start the discussion with Rachel Perry and from Artists Union, and then we will open up the floor to questions. So I'll just let Annie Shaw from Los Angeles start her presentation. Intern Labor Rights, as I said, is stemming out from Occupy Arts and Labor, and it's an arts advocacy group that is looking into the social conditions of unpaid labor and is creating campaigns awareness around interning in New York. So Annie, I don't know if you're there. I don't know if she can hear me.
I can hear you, and I'm...
And she's there, right. So I'll leave you to talk a little bit about intern labor rights then.
Great. Thanks, Aria. It's wonderful to see you tiny on the screen via Skype. And I think because of time, I'm actually going to go straight to intern labor rights, which, first of all, I want to acknowledge that intern labor rights is a working group of quite a few members. At this point, I would say we're still about like 6 to 8 members. And so I am speaking as one of the member of the group and sharing some of my perspective of kind of our history and the work that we have done, some of the strategies that we have used. At the same time, I would also want to say that, you know, each of our members have also a different experience with our group. And I just want to start with acknowledging that. So here you see May Day is coming, and this is actually an image of us in May Day 2 years ago. And I think these three visuals, basically these three signs that we made for our May Day marches, basically have summarized kind of the framework that we've been working with. One is that in the U.S., and based on the book Intern Nation by Ross Perlin, we think that there's about $2 billion worth of unpaid work that's done performed by unpaid interns. And again, this is a very low estimate because it's impossible to really track how much unpaid work has been performed. And then pay your interns, this idea that we have to start to pay our interns has been a central message in our group. And then and probably the most important message within this is that unpaid internships contribute to racial, class, and gender discrimination. Next slide. So this is our mission statement, and as I think one thing that maybe I can just give a little bit of history, as what Aria has said, we started, we were a group of strangers that met each other during Occupy Wall Street in 2011. We didn't exist before that. And we started as a working group of arts and labor, Occupy Arts and Labor, that eventually just kind of gradually broke out into its own group. Specifically, we focus the idea of unpaid labor that take form as unpaid internship. But if you can read our statement, the first thing we say in our slide, actually, in our mission, is that intern labor rights aims to raise awareness to the exploitation of unpaid laborers. So it's not just unpaid interns, but it's unpaid laborers. But we use intern labor as a starting point for this conversation. I'm not going to read out the whole entire statement, but I do want to emphasize that, you know, this was a time when it was this discussion was quite sensitive in the working environment to discuss. And so by calling this out and saying that we have, I also just want to say that we, in terms of membership, the people that did come together, we did say that we have experienced firsthand the detrimental effects of practice where workers contribute to their employer's success but receive no wages and compensation. Again, under the branch of intern labor rights, we're actually talking about unpaid labor, and then the idea of wages no wages and compensation, which, you know, Lise can probably talk about this with WAG.E further. And one more thing is to clarify is that unpaid internships is a direct violation of Fair Labor Standard Act, which does say that unpaid work, especially in the for-profit sector, is illegal. So there is a law that already kind of stand against us. However, in terms of implementation, it's a different issue. So next slide, please. So this is the six or seven points that we have using what we've learned from the fact sheet 71. Talk about how unpaid internships perpetuate, and we interpret it, you know, so it perpetuates class advantage by denying opportunity to those who cannot afford to work for free. And unpaid internships are not covered by workplace protections against sexual harassment and racial discrimination. It devaluates the fundamental dignity of work. it creates downward pressure on wages by forcing workers to compensate with free labor. It allows business owners and shareholders profit from the uncompensated labor of others, and it contribute to unemployment and inequality, and produce a culture of self-indignation in the workforce. So now, next slide, please. I want to, because of the context of kind of what, you know, we've talking about, I want to talk a little bit about our strategies. Next slide, please. And again, these strategies, some of them are intentional, and some of them, I would say, is unintentional. It's basically what happened, what we were able to do. And by calling these strategies, I'm not saying whether they're successful or unsuccessful. They were just things that we, tools that we used and structure that we created in time in the past 3-4 years. So one thing that I think is quite unique for our group is that for almost 3 years since our starting, we managed to hold weekly meetings at almost the same location, which is, you know, and we were not affiliated with Goethe Institute. It was actually, it's just a space that was available and central in Manhattan that was open every Sunday for anyone to use for free. But for some reason, no one ever used that space. And which is amazing to think in New York, but we managed to hold most of our weekly meetings on Sunday at this building. And if this building is occupied, then we held our meetings in coffee shop. Next slide, please. Somehow that image is missing. Can you go to the next slide? And one more. Well, there we go. So, the one before, please. So another thing that we managed to do in the past few years is about every 6 to 9 months, we were able to hold intern happy hours where interns from different fields met over and just at like a bar. Sometimes we got permission to do this at a bar, and sometimes we don't. We just showed up and held these meetings. Next slide, please. That's the intern happy hour, one of it. And our actions, we were not necessarily a direct action group. I would say some of my cohorts might speak about it differently, but our actions tend to be very focused on being informational. So for instance, this is a good example of a panel discussion that's called We'll Walk Work for Free. That was a panel discussion about intern labor economy that featured Ross Perlin from Intern Nation, Irma Rodriguez from Queens Community House, Rachel Bien, which is a nonprofit kind of organizing space in Queens, New York. Rachel Bien of Outen & Golden Law Firm, who has been carrying out a lot of the lawsuits based on unpaid internship, and our own member, Dendanu Surawira, who has been with our group for some time. So next. Another slide is missing here, but this is also, we've done quite a bit of outreach, for instance, one slide is missing for some reason, but we have actually basically flyered and done outreach in front of the New York job, NYU job fair, and we even did a outreach at Times Square. And similar kind of outreach has been done in that scale. They seem to be very soft action, but I think whatever that is, one is that it raised consciousness surely with the public sphere, but I also think that these actions raise consciousness within ourselves. As we force ourselves to talk to a wide set of public, we started formulating kind of our ideas of what this struggle is really about. Okay, next slide, please. One more. Okay, so I think one thing that's really important that I would say this is very intentional is that as art workers, and most of our groups started as art workers because we met under arts and labor, as art workers, we really did intentionally not make unpaid internship an art world only issue. We saw this as an issue that was a larger or a widespread kind of in a wide scale. And one more thing I did want to say, which I forgot to kind of address earlier. I think that intern labor rights partly started because we were in the middle of a huge movement, which was Occupy Wall Street. And there was so much huge philosophical existential debate about anything from what an art worker is to just what is art, what is the place of art at the first place, that intern labor rights really started with a few of us that wanted to focus on one very specific issue. And I would say that quite a few of us felt that this was a winnable issue. Now, however you define a win is something that we can discuss later. Next slide, please. Now, and I wanna say something that is about how that might be really central to our identity at this point. Our narratives did not just focus on how to get interns paid, but it is about how this is there is an entire generation of youth who cannot afford to work for free. And these youth are largely people of color who cannot afford unpaid internship. And they are therefore excluded from employment opportunities and career development. And this brings into the larger kind of conversation about, you know, race, class, and gender equity. Next slide, please. Now, and we have, I want to say another thing that kind of just the way we were formed, one of our key member also initiated one of the first major class action lawsuit against Fox Searchlight, hiring unpaid intern during the filming of Black Swan. To kind of just bring this into how unpaid internship was not just an art world issue, but it was an issue in it definitely prevalent in cultural work, if not obviously larger. Next, please. Next slide. As the slide is loading, I think the slides just crashed. But anyway, I'll just keep talking. Some of our other actions, for instance, we also did a campaign that was during New York Fashion Week in spring 2013, where we basically gave out these the slide after this one, please, gave out these goodie bags. And we basically kind of like just, you know, gave out these goodie bags to unpaid interns or anyone that was at Fashion Week and kind of raise awareness about internship issues. Next, go back up. And then we also worked with, you know, the UN interns on a solidarity action where a lot of times it wasn't just we reach out to the UN group actually reached out to us to create this action. Another solidarity action that we did, and because since the slides are not loading, but I can just talk about it, is the en masse wage theft. A solidarity action en masse is a worker center in Chinatown, New York, that have been actually around for about probably three decades of quite a radical working center with a history that have fought against a lot of sweatshop labor restaurant exploitations, tip-based labor. And one thing that they have been doing for a long time is to hold the hold the government accountable for actually just basically accountable for the law that they've developed. And for that reason, we actually marched in solidarity quite a few times in 2014 to basically support the workers' action to stop to demand the labor department to actually hold the bosses accountable for wage theft the way that they should hold especially for-profit companies accountable for not paying interns, which is illegal. Okay, next slide. And then, I want to address, and we can talk about this later, I do want to say that all of our own labor is volunteer-based in the work that we do for intern labor rights. We raise funds by selling tote bags only, and frankly, most of our action has mainly required time and energy, which again, this is something that I don't think it's as much as ideological at all, but more the reality of our work and how much time we are able to actually find funds for ourselves. I would say one thing, the tote bags have actually surprisingly been able to kind of help us to just do the very basic things, such as if we have a panel discussion, we can pay people for their time small actions when we just need to print things and things like that. We do insist on printing our own tote bags because we find this process solidarity building. So I just want to address a few allies real quick, and my time is almost up. Next slide, please. For instance, after a year, 2 years or so, as we were continuing to work on this campaign, the Nation Institute, it is 12 interns from the Nation Institute organized to demand for minimum wage from the Nation Institute, and they won. And this group really gave our group a big kind of energy to kind of continue the fight. They certainly contributed. They were in our meetings, and we certainly, had a lot of really valuable exchange with this group. Next, please. Of course, I should address, Precarious Workers Brigade earlier, very early on, set and model for us, actually. And then another thing is, then later on, we were able, when the movement became so big, and this is absolutely not only our work, I want to be very clear that we were a part of a much larger work that has been being done by many different people in many different ways. But at some point we actually managed to come together and meet as the International Coalition for Fair Internships. And there were seven to 10 different countries of kind of folks that have been organizing organizing against unpaid internships. Those groups include the UN group, then they are both in New York and Geneva, Intern Aware in Canada. I think Precarious Workers Brigade certainly joined in some of these conferences. There's there's a French group, I cannot speak, General Precaire, something like that. For that information, we met about twice over a course of a year to just really kind of talk about the work that we're doing. Next. So I want to just end with kind of talking about our challenges. Next. We as a group, we had a hard time recruiting current interns to organize their workplaces because the duration of their internship at their workplaces is often limited. I mean, we're talking about you have to do consciousness raising, solidarity building, awareness, you know, all of that within probably anything literally from 6 to 10 weeks. And another thing is that most of our members who stayed in the group are now managers and former interns. And then the next is that none of us, the key members of this group, are from the same workplace. And it has been very difficult for us to formulate direct actions around unpaid internship in the nonprofit industrial complex, which is legal. And then on top of it, the past 2 years, a few of our key members gradually, including myself, have moved to other cities due to job and life opportunities. But having said that, conversations are changing, and I'm actually going to just skip the last two slides, but to talk about the questions that I would like to just wrap with, which is, while there are now more institutions, you know, like that are paying interns, you know, MoMA, Creative Time, to, you know, Condé Nast, you know, Vice, the questions remain, will interns be learning from their experience? How does the payment and stipend compare to the institution's operating budget, especially like in city of New York, in London, you know, or even in LA? How should an internship be valued in comparison to a job? And I would push this to, should internship be abolished? Is it possible to establish an industry-wide hiring practice where intentional decisions are being made to create a workplace, right? This is not just internship. That is intersectional in race, class, and gender. I'm just going to end with that. Thank you.
Thanks. Can you hear me? Can she hear me? No.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, okay. Well, thanks. That was amazing, and I think that it's incredibly relevant to Precarious Workers Brigade and in particular. And I think that the conversation will probably continue when we finish the presentations. I did say that there were time for questions. There was time for questions, but that's not true anymore. So. I'm just going to go into the next presentation, and I'm really, really happy to have Lise with us. Lise is an artist who is part of W.A.G.E. W.A.G.E. stands for Working Artists and the Greater Economy, and it's a New York-based activist group whose advocacy is currently focused on regulating the payment of artist fees by nonprofit art institutions and establishing a sustainable model for best practices between artists and the institutions that contract their labor. So, Lise, I'll leave it to you, and maybe for this one we can have one question later. Thank you.
Hi, can you hear me? Can you guys hear me? Okay, I'll just assume that, yes, okay, great. I hope there'll be time for questions, but the presentation's a little bit dense. I'm just gonna launch right into it after saying thank you so much to Aria and Vlad for including W.A.G.E. Okay, so I kind of wrote this presentation to try to keep it tight. So bear with me, I'll try to sound like I'm not reading. So W.A.G.E. is a single issue organization. We're focused on regulating the payment of artist fees by nonprofit art institutions, as Aria mentioned, symbolized by this ridiculously rudimentary demand, the inclusion of artist fees as its own distinct invisible line item in institutions' operating budgets. Next slide. So I'm going to actually give you a kind of history. Aria wanted me to talk about the development of W.A.G.E. certification. So by doing that, I'm going to give you a bit of a history of W.A.G.E. starting from around 2010, even though W.A.G.E. was founded in 2008. The first 2 years were focused on consciousness raising around the issue of non-payment, while also preparing the 2010 artist survey, which gathered data about the payment practices of nonprofits between 2005 and 2010. So the survey results confirmed what we suspected and only knew anecdotally to be true up to that point. And this slide is the most important result that we found, which is that almost 54%, 58.4% of respondents received no form of compensation, including the coverage of expenses. Next slide. So this this slide shows survey data in which institutions provided any form of payment, going from 8% of the time on the left to 100% of the time on the right. And so on the right is the kitchen, I believe, and on the left is Performa. So I'm showing this because it indirectly forms the basis of wage certification's fee calculator in its representation of art institutions on a gradient. So that means looking at them as entities with institutional practices that can be quantified and compared and therefore standardized. Okay, next slide, please. So WAGE did its first certification in 2010 of the exhibition Free at the New Museum. So at that time, it wasn't clear that we'd turn this into what it is now. It was more of a solution to a problem, which was curator Lauren Cornell invited us to participate in the exhibition as an artist. But because WAGE is not an artist and what we do is not art, we're very clear about that, and it's actually quite important. We instead chose to contribute by negotiating fees for all of the participating artists. So there were other demands that weren't met, but this one was, and it constitutes our first ever certification. Next slide. So shortly after that, we were contacted by Artist Space, also here in New York, which is a 43-year-old nonprofit organization here that wanted to be certified. Because under the new directorship of Stefan Kalmar, they were paying substantial artist fees and they wanted to be recognized for that. So like our engagement with the new museum, we didn't know exactly what the nature of our relationship with them would be. At that point, all we knew was that certification could not and should not be for single exhibitions and instead had to reflect a long-term commitment to artists on the part of an institution. So at this point, we decided that certification would be for institutions only and not for single exhibitions. Next slide. So the partnership with Artist Space marked the beginning of the development of certification in earnest, although at the time we thought that certifying Artist Space would simply be a matter of looking at Carfax fee schedule. So Carfax is Canadian Artist Representation, and this is just a little snippet of their fee schedule. We thought all we had to do was kind of look at that and then augment their fees to reflect our own context. Next slide. But of course, that was totally naive. We quickly realized that it was going to be far more complex than that. Next slide. So we knew that any fee schedule was going to have to account for the huge range of institutional models out there and that we needed to know as much as we could about the specific contingencies that determine the conditions under which they function. So this includes things like size, whether they rent or own, their mission and history, access to funding, etc. Of course, there are a lot more than that, but those are the primary ones that come to mind. Next slide. So when we released the results of our survey in 2012, 2 years after we did the survey, we also presented some research into Artist Space's history of fee payment over the same time frame, 2005 to 2010. So full disclosure, I worked at Artist Space as the grant writer between 2011 and 2014. So there was kind of an aspect to this that was like being embedded in the organization. I was working, from the inside as a grant writer, but also as WAGE. So that was actually really important. It was complicated and difficult, but important. So this research was critical because, like the visualization of the survey data that I showed you before, it organized information comparatively, and in doing so, showed the actual value of artist labor as a percentage of the organization's total operating expenses. So through this number, you can see exactly how much they chose to spend on paying the artists whose work the organization was founded to support. Next slide. So we also compared what Artist Space paid, as you can see, to what Carfax would have recommended. And as you can also see, it made very little difference. It's between, I think this slide says 1.4% and 3% of the total budget. So you can just show the next three slides fairly quickly. They're just the next 3 years. You just see the kind of same thing, and also how there's no consistency to the fee size and type. Next slide. This is 2008. Yeah, go ahead to the next one. Okay, you can just go one more and then stop at the one after that. Okay, next one. Great, you can just stay there for a second. So prior to presenting, to making this presentation, the director, Stefan Kalmar, who I mentioned, he saw these slides and he insisted that we show, he sort of freaked out and said, because this did not represent what he felt he was doing at ArtistSpace. He insisted that we show something that reflected the fees that ArtistSpace was paying under his tenure. So we included an exhibition budget from that year. I can't remember what show this is, but you can see that the fee was $2,000. But as you can also see, a lot of money was spent on the production of the work, because they do a lot of commissioning of new work, single, like solo exhibitions with commissions of new work. So this was critical, because we had to consider what kinds of non-monetary compensation artists might be receiving beyond the fee, and try to understand and determine whether they should be taken into account in relation to the fee size. All right, next slide, please. So this wage graphic represents that thinking that I just described and maps some of the internal institutional contingencies that we needed to consider as part of certification. So referring back to our first revelation that I described and showed another wage graphic of, in which we understood that certification had to account for the contingencies external to the institution, the things that from without impact upon what it's able to do, such as size, real estate cost, mission history, funding, etc. This revelation had to do with contingencies that are internal to it, so the policies and practices that determine what it is able to do. Okay, next slide. All right. So the next pivotal development was defining what the fee was payment for. So we had always been talking about artist compensation in terms of fees and not waged labor, which is an important distinction. But under certification, we defined it even more narrowly as being a fee for the work that you do when you enter into a transactional relationship with an arts organization, which includes but is not limited to preparation, installation, presentation, consultation, exhibition, and reproduction. So we're not trying to monetize the process of making an artwork or the artwork itself. We're not talking about the number of hours an artist may have spent in the studio or in reading groups or in Depot. We're really just talking about the work that you do in conjunction with an organization to mount an exhibitional program. All right, next slide. So next came the definition of equity. And this resulted from another experimental certification of the Steirischer Herbst Festival in Graz in Austria, which was invited to certify Truth is Concrete, which you guys may have heard about, a seven-day marathon camp looking at art and politics and art, and Precarious Workers Brigade was there. Hello to them again. So we worked with the festival's administrator who turned this question around on us and asked, what does equity mean to wage? Out of which came this statement. So the phrase, payment must be conceived and established in direct relation to what an institution chooses to pay its employees and subcontractors, is really important here, because it's the first time we're defining artist labor on par with all of the other forms of labor within an organization. We hadn't done that previously. So you might be noticing a pattern here. First, that we have a habit of entering into relationships with institutions. And second, that significant developments happen in internal policy, wage policy, when we do. So this is key to how wage functions. It's sort of a balance of being able to work with institutions while retaining the ability to be critical of them at the same time. All right, next slide. So out of the work with Truth is Concrete came an early tenet of certification, which was later voted down actually by consensus in its establishment into a policy at the Wage Summit, which I'm going to talk about briefly in a bit. So initially the idea was to use the artist fee as a starting point in considering the value of all labor within an organization. So for a long time, there was some text on our website that said, quote, adjustments to employees' salaries might also be recommended to bring them up to a standard that is equitable to the investment being made in artists or the production of artists' work, unquote. So there was also a proposal, not on our website, to regulate gender representation and racial or ethnic diversity within an organization's programming and within its staff composition. So this was also really important. It speaks to what Annie was talking about as well, about access and barriers to entry within the art field in general. Next slide. Sorry, I hope I'm not going too fast. I'm just kind of speeding through this because I know we're short on time. So it seems like I'm just throwing this slide in for kicks, but it actually describes certification as proposed to the Wage Summit, both attitudinally and in terms of its framework. So transparent, referring to all mechanisms for valuation and compensation, are clear. holistic, meaning the entire ecosystem within which the institution functions is considered, as is its own ecosystem. Ratio, which is the artist fee being measured in relation to the operation in some form. And budget, of course, represents the means of the institution, its value in monetary terms. So next slide, please. All right, so by the time of the 2014 wage summit, which took place in January of that year, there was a pretty cogent proposal for wage certification in place, which was based on the 2 to 3 years of research and development that I just outlined. So the summit, the 8 or so people whose names you see on the screen there, essentially locked themselves in a room for 2 days and turned the proposal that essentially WAGE brought to the summit into a fee schedule or calculator. Which is what became our fee calculator that you now see on our website. And I'm sorry, I'm describing this as though everyone's already familiar with it, because I was informed that that was true. I really hope that you guys know what wage certification is, although I am going to talk about it now. So hopefully, if you don't know what it is, it's going to make sense to you shortly. So the summit was a highly structured event. It wasn't just 2 days of meandering conversation. There were 8 sessions over 2 days, each of which was intended to lead to very specific outcomes based on the proposal brought by WAGE and based on the research of the 2 years that I just talked about. The debate and discussion at the summit formed the basis of certification's policy, which was developed over the following 6 months in consultation with other individuals and organizations. So next slide. So wage certification is based on a principle of self-regulation and on the assumption, or wager, if you want to put it that way, that art institutions would respond more favorably to appeals on ethical grounds and in relation to their carefully cultivated reputations than on the possibility of any external regulation that, in the context of the U.S., is basically never going to happen. So wage certification is not in lieu of government regulation, but in the absence of it accepts that economic value in the art field is determined via the construction of an artist's reputation by a relative elite made up of curators, critics, academics, collectors, museums, etc. The construction of value is very much tied to the exceptional status of art and artists and the moral authority they seem to have by being exceptional, by seeming to operate outside of commerce. And this mechanism is definitive of the nonprofit art institution. Its exceptional status as a 501c3, which is its designation in this country, means that it's exempt from taxation and is eligible for subsidies, making it appear to operate outside of the commercial marketplace. But ironically, it's precisely the nonprofit's moral authority that increases the monetary value of the art and artists that pass through it in the form of exhibitions and programs. So the logic is, if it's exhibited in a nonprofit institution, it serves the public good and therefore must have value beyond commerce. And it's exactly this perception that adds value to art when it reaches the commercial auction and sales markets. So that's just sort of a very tight overview of why nonprofits and why we're choosing to certify them in this way and bypassing state regulation. Next slide. All right, so I'm just now going to go on to the policy itself. So I'm going to give, I was trying to give a fairly brief overview. Wage certification was conceived as a self-regulatory model in response to an entrenched, I'm reading this stuff because it's already really cogent, so it's better than me kind of trying to paraphrase what I've already written. So wage certification was conceived as a self-regulatory model in response to an entrenched resistance to external regulation by both institutions and artists, often expressed as a self-described allergy to bureaucracy. This resistance manifests within institutions as an ambivalence to articulate in any concrete way the terms of their engagement with artistic labor. But likewise, artists accept this state of ambiguity as a convenient means of maintaining perceived autonomy of their work and practice. So WAGE does not accept ambivalence and ambiguity as conditions for determining rates of pay. And this program is an effort to eradicate these conditions by advocating for definition and hyperclarity and against the creation of sub-exceptions within an already exceptional economy. So hence the following definitions, and this one's really important. The definition of artist as being inclusive of any discipline is critical. The term artist is more of a placeholder for anyone that provides services or supplies content in a visual arts presenting context. So that's the full definition. So next slide. I'm not sure if I should, you know, read this along with you, or if you want to just go and you can find all of this stuff on our website. Yeah, that's good. Thanks. So the artist fee, let's see. Yeah, you can go on to the next one. Okay. So we've also defined what we call basic programming costs and services. The idea here is that as contemporary conditions of precarity increasingly necessitate that workers supply the workplace infrastructure like laptop, cell phone, mobile office, etc., W.A.G.E. asserts that in a visual arts context, the opposite is true. The institution, if nothing else, is the infrastructure that cannot be provided by the artist. So basic programming costs are not negotiable. They are the responsibility of the host institution and are required for certification. So these are totally separate from the fee, and this makes clear and sure that they can't be taken out of the fee, or the fee can't be used, applied to these costs. So next, please. So this is what those things include. And again, you guys can look at this on our website for in a slower fashion. All right, next one, please. Production costs. So we elected not to make production costs a condition of certification because it would prohibit smaller institutions with lesser means from being certified. And it would also imply a kind of value judgment on our part by saying that if you can't pay for production costs, you're not, you know, eligible for certification. It just didn't seem fair or right. So whether or not the sale of the work produces revenue for artists or institution, certification doesn't recognize the coverage of production costs as a form of compensation, because you could look at this as kind of non-monetary compensation if the work is later sold, it produces revenue for the artist. But if we did that, to consider production as a monetizable investment would require addressing the second life of the work in the commercial marketplace, and as such would mean recognizing artistic labor as a form of commodity production, thus encouraging capital-intensive projects and their circulation within the speculative market. So instead, W.A.G.E. certification locates itself within a services model, defining compensation on the basis of content or services provided, and that's really important too. So next slide. Am I running out of time? I don't know if I'll be hearing anybody.
Actually,
I still have 2 pages. Okay, sorry. I should have timed myself here. What should I do? Let's see. Well, I don't know. I mean, if I'm 1 minute over, I don't know what more I can really explain. I mean, if everybody's already familiar with W.A.G.E. certification, then you don't even need to do this. But I'd have no idea, since I can't see anybody. Yeah.
I know the tech is difficult. I know that a few people know about the certification in the room. I don't know if everybody does. But,
all right.
If you want to conclude with any kind of comment or suggestion, or I mean, you can do so. Otherwise, no.
Yeah. I mean, I don't really know what to say. I mean, there's a minimum W.A.G.E. in this program that's really critical. You know, the importance of a W.A.G.E. floor is really important. I don't know. I mean, there's really a lot to say. I guess it's really difficult to do this in such a short amount of time. But sorry that I wasn't able to give a cogent overview.
No. That was it was really amazing, and I think that it does relate to what I was saying before a little bit about the articulation and theoretical frameworks in a way, because I believe that all the operations that have been shown up until now, including the certification, has to do much with language, content, and especially with signification and what we mean for work and artists and all these terms. And that really came up out of your presentation, and that's really part of the general discourse, and I think that a lot of people can relate to that. So if there are no further slides, then I would give the floor to Precarious Workers Brigade, if that's okay with you. And if you two could stay online, we'll have questions in another 15 to 20 minutes. So I'm just going to go with Precarious Workers Brigade. I'm going to invite them to the stage and they can get set up.
From beginning.
Yeah, I tried that. Resume slideshow. What happens when we play the next one?
It doesn't go.
Maybe we can try.
It was working great earlier.
Yeah. This is it?
That's it. Well done. Great. Yeah. Okay.
And I guess you can just go slide by slide.
And the notes are there.
They can. That's terrific. Thank you, Aria. We're good to go.
Yeah. Okay. I'll leave you the floor.
All right. Well, it's absolutely marvelous to be here. My name is Marsha, and this is Vera and Tatiana, and we're representing the Precarious Workers Brigade. But as Annie was saying, we also work collectively, and so there are many in our ranks, including Aria and Jana. So I just wanted to acknowledge that the stories we're going to tell today are really from our perspective, and many other tales could certainly be told. If you go to our website, you will learn that we are a UK-based group of precarious workers in culture and education. And we call out in solidarity to all those struggling to make a living in this climate of instability and enforced austerity. And we invite you to join us in learning, creating, and struggling together. So we're hoping by offering you three different points of access into the Precarious Workers Brigade that we will paint a maybe more robust picture of what we do, as well as a slightly more intimate one. We'll give you a sense of what keeps us awake at night and what we're trying to do to change it in the days ahead. So once upon a time, long, long ago in the noughties, before PWB was a twinkle in anyone's eye, there was a group called the Carrot Workers Collective. And it was around about 2008 that I learned about this dynamic group of interns and ex-interns who were very much engaged with unpaid labor in the sectors of culture and education. And this was at the same time that we were experiencing this thing called the economic downturn, which we know was bad for the majority but very good for a minority. And by 2010, there was real growing resistance to the decimating cuts that we were experiencing in education and in the arts as a direct result of the banking bailout. And as many of you know, this was the result of mismanagement of funds, and the government decided that rather than let these banks fail, that it made sense to use taxpayers' money to keep them afloat. Many of us believe this was tantamount to public mugging, and this is effectively what we are protesting here as part of the Precarious Workers Brigade. You will see our motto, the carrot. It is a symbol of promise and hope on the one hand, the desire for a better life as a cultural producer, but it's also a symbol of control on the other, kind of the carrot and the stick idea, that so long as we behave, we're all right, but if we don't, then we are subject to being punished. So this was one of my earliest experiences with this group, along with 50,000 others on the front lines in the demonstration. And it was around about the same time that the Carrot Workers Collective were invited by the ICA in London to do a residency. And this was very interesting because it was sort of part of a season of dissent, the idea that you could present political content within institutions, but the question, of course, always is, then how does that actually politicize the institution? What change does it make? And so I think out of a desire to open up what this possibility might entail, the Carrot Workers Collective invited all kinds of groups across London and beyond to join them. And the result was a residency that was reduced from a month long to a day, an afternoon, for reasons that I regret I can't go into here, but I can assure you they were complex, they were challenging, they nearly brought us to our knees. What we produced was a participatory tribunal. This is what you're looking at here, and it focused on precarity, and it was a life-changing experience for me. This was because I listened to my peers share their stories about their experience working under precarious conditions, and I could identify them. Some of them were anonymized, other people spoke from their own experience directly, and the result was an extraordinary array of evidence that then was wrapped up through a process of deliberation that resulted in a series of verdicts at the end of the day. And this is what you see here on the bottom right-hand corner. Subsequent to that, because we wanted to think about how we could translate these verdicts, I suppose, into action to go forward, how we might be able to affect change in our institutions and beyond, we developed something called the alternative curriculum. And this is something that is ongoing, but essentially, as you can see from the table of contents, it's a resource pack. And the idea is that it presents various resources that, students and educators can use to think about precarity as a systemic issue, and critically, to think about how educational institutions are implicated in this system. So before I hand over to Vera, I just want to acknowledge that this was realized in 2012. It's online. However, we are currently updating this resource pack, and so we look forward to getting that out sometime in the late spring, early summer.
Yeah, hi, I'm Vera, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how it is to organize as an intern in the workplace and how we go about it as Precarious Workers Brigade. And I used to be an intern in a charity. I'm one of the non-artists in the Precarious Workers Brigade. So it goes beyond that. So the issue is that we all love volunteering. I love volunteering, and everyone loves their volunteers. And so there's so much love that it can sometimes be very hard about talking about pay, a very critical issue. So, you know, as we volunteer, you know, we develop our skills apparently, and, you know, does it actually end up in a job? All these questions emerge. So the Precarious Works Brigade has these little cards, which you also find outside, to remind yourself sometimes to bust your boss. And one of the questions we tell you what a right you have is that you have the right not to remain silent about money and not to subsidize the production from your own pocket, more for the artist, less for the non-artist like me, not to accept the change of agreed conditions without renegotiation, and not to take this job on the promise of a future, which is of course an issue for many unpaid internships. And also we want to remind ourselves that this work or this boss can, you know, be sometimes your friend. It can sometimes come in the form of unpaid over hours. It can sometimes come some various things. It can even be you when you do work for free, maybe where you should demand a wage or compensation as a freelancer. The other thing is when we then in our workplace, in my intern workplace, decided we want to negotiate with our boss about it. There are many ways to do so, and our first try failed terribly. And then we, you know, got back and saw we need to actually read a bit more about. And the Precarious Workers Brigade, and this is how I really got involved with them, is about this amazing counter guide to free labor in the arts, and it's also very useful for non-artists like me. And we are currently also updating this version, but the old version is outside on the table, so you can have a look if you're interested. The next thing I want to talk about is, you know, obviously there are different ways of, like, questioning why one should do an internship or maybe not do an internship, and that there are alternatives, and we would love to discuss that. If one decides to do an internship, we argue that you always have the option to do your own militant research, which might lead to organizing. So one of the questions you can ask, and I asked myself when I did this unpaid internship, is there a high pay ratio in your organization? In my organization, definitely there was one. The organization started on a flat pay scale, and it was growing bigger and bigger and bigger. So that's also the answer to the second question, is the pay gap increasing? Yes, it is for the bosses, and while unpaid labor is now the norm in many charities. Has this unpaid internship been a job before? Through a leaked document, I definitely heard that my job was actually a paid job before, so it's another example of how entry-level positions, other positions are actually replaced, jobs are replaced with unpaid labor. And then could this lead to a job? In my charity, that was definitely no, because the first position you can actually enter in this organization was you need 4 years paid work experience. And then also you can ask other questions, you know, would I do the same work if I were a man? You know, if what
color, race, we can all talk about these things. And we can see that research has been done where you see that your accent in the UK has an impact on what type of work you do. Same as, you know, if you're a woman, you're less likely to do clerical work than actually content work. So these are things, you know, if you think about doing internship worthwhile looking at. If you then decide that you want to organize, it's very difficult, as our colleagues on the Yes already said, you know, it's difficult to actually meet other interns. Their email address is not on the website usually, and how do you get in touch? And an internship is very short, so it makes organizing very difficult. So we as Precarious Workers Brigades have these monthly drop-in sessions where you can come also with other issues, not necessarily just unpaid internships, but where we actually want to get together and offer each other advice from people who have done campaigning before and, you know, think about campaigning. So our motto is stop complaining, start campaigning. Right, so there are many obstacles to organize, but we did organize and we managed to stop unpaid internships at our workplace, so it's possible. But if looking back, I think there's one issue which I really regret, is, and this is the issue of love again, as we all tend to love our work so much, it's quite hard to shame an organization you're so deeply in love with. So I think it is a key, and many organizations, for example, Boycott Workfare, I'm not sure who is aware, who knows about them, they did massive naming and shaming campaigns in the UK very successfully, and I think it's possible, and for me, naming and shaming is definitely a very powerful tool, strategy tool. And I'm sad that our group didn't have the courage to do it at that time, but that's maybe something we can learn from it. So we had partial success, we stopped unpaid internships, but what we wanted was jobs, paid jobs, and we didn't get a pay job. So that's. I hand over to Tatiana now about the naming
change. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Marcia, and thank you, Bear. That was an exciting start. So my name is Tatiana, and I'm going to... Oh, it's actually very hard to see the audience from here. And what I would talk about, I would try to talk a bit about how I joined PWB and a bit more about the futures, and it will touch on consciousness raising, on ethics, and where the hell do we go from here. I started working with Precarious Workers Brigade, cooperating and collaborating with PWB a few years ago. I think I was sucked into that process. A few of you may remember the action in the Serpentine Gallery. Maybe you haven't even heard about that, but it was a bunch of young people dressed up as Santas. They came into the two venues in Serpentine Gallery in Kensington Gardens with a banner, "Future interns, all we want for Christmas is pay." They were giving out the leaflets with the demystified advert for 3-month unpaid internship, and they were giving out those lovely scrolls to the audience, and audience spectators in the gallery, they were usually very friendly and grateful for us coming there. It was an interesting interaction between Serpentine and PWB. We achieved quite a lot and quite quickly. They gave out the unpaid scheme for interns, the 3-month unpaid scheme, but they introduced a few more new things. So the major question that came out for me, and I suppose for people who participated in that action, was how much we can actually achieve with direct action if the government is okay with people working for free. Doesn't mean we have to go and stand in front of HMRC office and campaign there. That was a big deal, but that's one of the big questions that I think is still in the air, how much we can actually achieve with campaigning, and where do we go after that. Another important moment I wanted to mention in relation to Precarious Workers Brigade and my involvement in that, I think the group made a huge influence on what happened to my life, and I wanted to mention the issue of consciousness raising and how important was that. The group uses pedagogical and organizational aspects of work. They all come together, they're never separated. There is a lot of accent of denaturalizing the work and the situation in which we work. We talk a lot about problems of romance and idealism in the cultural sector, and we talk about desires that exist, that are still there, that are very common among cultural workers, and conditions in which we live, our individualized, competitive, hierarchical structures which we inhabit. So consciousness raising was great, and but I think it's something interesting that it does to a person. Like, you become slightly unemployable, I imagine. I suppose some of you may have been once young, quite unskilled, possibly a bit educated, and maybe a bit too conscious. So the question of where do you go from there? And do you go? Can you start working in Serpentine, or can you actually start? And in what kind of institution you could work? So that was like where this carrot could come from, and this carrot is something that feeds you. So one of the answers for me on that question was cooperatives. I'm involved in a sort of a social experiment of trying to set up a worker cooperative, Ceramic Students of London, and I kind of come from that experience. What I think is hugely valuable about cooperatives is that the values and principles are something that I can easily support. Self-help, autonomy, democracy, equality, equity, and solidarity, this is something I can stand by, and I know that I can be proud of the organization that can actually try to put those values into action. So it's one of the modes of self-help. So the question for me was like, what kind of it seems like one of the needs that we currently have, as I think as young people and those who are able to survive outside academia, is how do you organize and what kind of institutions we should build. So a few notes for that kind of new institutions. I think it's really important for them to have values we support. We do need to talk about economic sustainability, as all the groups mentioned now, and it's important to think about democratic governance structures and who takes decisions and how do we take them. What are the public interests that we can support with these institutions, and can we actually support public interests through building these new institutions, building enterprises, businesses, non-profit organizations that can actually feed us. Common ownership is something that PWB will stand behind, and control by people who work in them is really important. And I'm quite excited that co-ops can actually be a good way of doing that. So I suppose this is a call for new institutions. On the other way, they don't have to be cooperatives. There are other ways of doing that. But one of the things I found out from the very start of this little organization that's not quite a proper co-op yet, obviously, it's that by organizing economically with other people and trying to protect our ourselves in relation to economy, we start seeing capitalism in a very different way. Not that we become more capitalist, but the institutions can become a critical tool for talking about capitalism. They become the default critical institutions, but we don't have to face that critique. We don't have to raise that critique as individuals. This can be done on institutional level. So I suppose that's kind of it. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you.
Really? No. I think that's mine. Thank you.
I wanted to thank everybody, and I wanted to invite everybody up to sit behind the mics so we can answer questions. And Rachel as well, if you want to sit with us. And Vlad, where is Vlad? Yeah.
I think we have enough chairs, actually.
I'll stay here.
Okay.
You can moderate. Okay. So if we can turn on the lights so everybody can wake up And so what I would do before, where's Rachel? There she is. Before Rachel presents a little bit Artists Union, I would start a little bit, like ask two quick questions maybe on the presentations that we've had. And I'm actually curious to know, I mean, the interesting thing for me throughout the whole presentations is how the articulation of protest is actually happening within an art, like coming from an artistic discourse and going into a larger sort of area of struggle. And I think that all three speakers, and Lisa and Annie are online as well, I hope. I think all three groups are a good example of that. And they challenge also the way we conceive what labor is, what labor is not, and how we conceive as well artistic production and artistic institutions. So given that, I would like to have the different speakers relate to each other in a way and speak a little bit about what they think of a new language and new words and how maybe they're implementing this. Maybe it's a large question, but it would be great to have. Yeah.
I would actually like to pick from each speaker's presentation, which were, by the way, really great. I think that Annie said something, a caption in her presentation read something like, as art workers, we want to make sure that people understand we don't refer to art interns only. And for me, it's really interesting, this connection between being an art worker, but you know, not referring to art interns only. And then Lisa said, we want to make sure that this is not art, so what W.A.G.E. does is not art. And then in the Precarious Workers Brigade presentation, I'm actually really fascinated by, you know, like but this event of the tribunal, which I was really lucky to participate in 2010, and the tribunal definitely had an aesthetic dimension, so there was a direct connection with art. So I'm actually curious, how do you see yourselves in relation to each other? Do you think there are any sort of big ideological differences between the three groups, but specifically in relation to recognizing yourselves as art workers or operating in the field of art or in the larger field of culture or whatever?
Those are big questions, but are you ready for them?
Yeah,
I'm looking at you because you should sit there.
Okay, all right. I'll give another chance.
Because then no one would be able to listen to hear you.
You're still looking at me. Okay.
Yeah. I am.
I was also struck, and it would be good, Lies, to hear why, because you were actually quite careful about that. You articulated the importance of differentiating what you do from artistic practice. Mm. So I'd like to hear more about that. I would be interested to hear what my comrades from the Precarious Workers Brigade think on this issue, because personally, I am very comfortable with what we do being both art and non-art. For me, it's not productive to be prescriptive, per se. But by the same token, I also appreciate that others have much more ideologically invested views in it being activism in contrast to art. So fortunately, we're a broad church and can accommodate different perspectives.
I think for me it's quite difficult to answer that because I'm clearly not an artist and I don't define myself as an artist, so I don't really think that I'm, even though I'm part of Precarious Workers Brigade, because it reaches beyond the issue of art, because it's, you know, all about free labor and it's not just an issue, which is an issue in the art, but in other sectors as well. So I think I should, my artist, let's answer the question.
I mean, there is a certain relevance of that question, but
you
on
have
that.
To speak closer to the mic, otherwise.
Okay, I'll just sit here. So, I don't really understand how that question is relevant at this point. I mean,
I think it's relevant because I don't understand
the, like, yes, it is important to discuss, yes, but on the other hand, is direct action art? Mm-hmm, exactly. Like, why would that be art? I think lots of things in the practice of Precarious Workers Brigade has deeply propagandistic kind of purpose. Like, is propaganda, I really don't understand why is it helpful to discuss that now.
I would wait. There's somebody.
Hi, it's Annie. I just want to maybe, I'm not sure whether it's a direct response either, but I wanted to clarify that as an art worker working in the internship rights issue, labor rights issue, we identify this issue not being an art world only issue. We identified it as a larger working condition that all of us live under. And for that reason, we needed solidarity to build solidarity with anyone that's living under that condition. And of course, ultimately, the network that we were able to reach out to and people that responded to our community, I would say, are at least largely cultural worker, if not art worker, right? And we can go on and debate whether it's culture, art, and that's definitely, I think there is definitely space for that discussion. Actually, I think it's really important actually to ask us, what is art versus art world versus culture?
In relation to your presentation, I was really curious why you insisted on the term art worker and not cultural worker, because I think it says something about, you know, like how much empowered you are or you see yourself in relation to issue of unpaid interns, for example. So why is art worker?
I can't speak for my group. I think my other, like some of our other, you know, cohorts would probably talk about this very differently. My insistence, my personal insistence to continue to use the word art worker was because when we first used this word, and that's not only, you know, intern labor rights, but it as arts and labor during Occupy, that word was very much contended and rejected. And for that reason, I wanted to insert that space to continue to identify myself in that term. While cultural worker, actually, to be honest, I'm not able to give you a very kind of like direct answer or philosophical answer. I mean, well, or I can, but it will take some time. I'm not quite sure how to put it, but somehow the art worker term, for at least in the time that I radicalized, was a contended term that I felt like I need to reclaim. So I will just speak about that personally.
Okay.
Wanted to know if Lise was online as well, if she...
Yeah, I'm here.
If she had any comments.
Sorry, can you say that again?
If you had any comments.
I guess I'll just directly address the question, why wage is not art and why we speak about it that way. I think because we wanted to make a distinction between our work as attempting to affect actual systemic change or symbolic change. I mean, it may be that 7 years after WAGE's founding, that's not relevant, but actually I can tell you that it's incredibly relevant on a material level right now, in particular, in terms of WAGE trying to fund itself, which is, you know, when you get to this point in, you know, after doing this for so long, we actually really need to get paid now. And we did a crowdfunding campaign recently and closed this gap, managed to raise a lot of money with the support of our peers because we are generally ineligible for funding from foundations precisely because they want to fund social practice and not actual, whatever you want to call it, activism. I personally don't love using that word, but they want to fund artists who may be in a formation of an organization or a nonprofit, but who are were making socially conscious artwork and not what we're doing, which, you know, I don't want to pin it down exactly, but, you know, we're trying to regulate an industry. So we're unable to get funding on that basis. So, and the other reason, which is, I guess, fairly obvious, is that we don't want to call it art because we don't want to risk getting subsumed into institutions, which has also happened to us. Like, for example, when we did that research partnership with Artist Space that I was talking about, there was a question about whether we should get paid to do it. Were we an organization? Were we a collective of artists? What kind of content were we providing? Were we collaborating with them? I mean, I actually think it's really important, but that may be really particular to the context in which WAG.E works, and it may be particular to the United States. I'm not exactly sure. That's my answer.
Well, on that note, I wanted to introduce you to Rachel Perry from Artists Union. Oh, thank you. And I just wanted Rachel to kind of talk briefly about what Artists Union is and why you're participating, and then maybe relate to these questions and what has been said up until now.
Okay, well, first of all, thank you for inviting me to talk on behalf of the Artists Union England. Firstly, I'm an artist, and I live within the realms of live art and performance art, so I'm kind of like the bastard child of the art world, not quite fitting in and not always being paid properly. People thinking that they can just ask you to just open an event or that kind of thing. The Artist Union was created last year in 2013, and we have a first birthday party coming up on May the 1st in London. It's made some really important steps. Before I joined, even as a member, the founding members, Angela Kennedy, Catriona Beals, and Sally Schneeman, together investigated why a union should exist for artists. They basically had a look at how they could break away from often ingrained institutionalized expectations of this treatment to the artists, bringing together all walks of life in the collective action, collective bargaining, and workplace representation. In basic terms, the Artists Union England responds to a need for a body to support and serve its artists. A democratic body away from employers to act impartially and for fair treatment on behalf of these members. Many creative fields already have a union to ensure good practice, so why shouldn't artists? So the initial members basically created their first rule book and gained union status, an independent democratic voice. Sorry, I'm having a dyslexic moment and lost my space. I might just talk away from this, reading this, and just talk about some of the reasons I joined. I think ultimately, as an artist, I've reflected over 10 years worth of practice. Don't get me wrong, I've had some wonderful times. I've traveled the world with my work. Some places were actually mentioned on WAG.E's list of places that I've been to and not been paid properly, which was really interesting. One of them doesn't exist anymore. I think that the more I learnt about the Artists Union, it kind of fitted with my own ethics that it wasn't just about me. My art practice isn't just about me. I make politically driven work for raising consciousness and awareness of specific issues. And within the Artists Union, it felt right to, within this area of austerity, looking at how other unions were working, the fact that that internship, you know, we were saying people aren't being paid right in internships, the fact that people have a distance in a kind of economical kind of. So, for example, I come from a working class background, and I never thought that I could ever follow my dreams until somebody said to me, you know, you're an artist and you don't even know it. And being given that opportunity to go to university, and then granted, still being paid back, the fact that I was given that opportunity to further my career, open my mind and see the world in different ways is most important thing. And with the fees increasing and the kind of social divide getting bigger every day, I think that it's a massive issue and worrying. So I only joined in December, I put myself forward for an executive member so I could actually have a say. And it doesn't mean that any of you out there, if you're an artist, if you've ever shown work, been reviewed, if you've got a degree, if you haven't, you can join in the debates too, have your voice heard. And the reason the Artists Union England is so important is because we're working towards getting our final stage of certificate, which will give us a legal standing. It means that while we are very supportive of people like AN and the Artists Arts Council England, etc., they are employers. So myself, having a tricky moment a few years ago where my day job employers brought me forward and said, hey, we did some research on you and we found out that you're an artist, like it was a dirty word, and then brought forth some images of my work. And I was like, what's the problem? And then they said, well, you're saying that you're radical, you're a feminist. Kind of a think of the children moment. And I had a 2-year case where I had to fight to say that being an artist is not a bad thing. My own union that I belong to, that was within that industry, pretty much refused to support me. So I had to seek out private support. So what the Artists Union England and why I've put myself forward for this kind of case is that I want to be that person, or collectively gather information to support other artists that may have similar or many other different issues. They range.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
It's okay.
But unfortunately, we're going overtime here. And also, I mean, that was a wonderful presentation. And I think there are a lot of issues that are in relation to the other groups. But this idea of self-conscious and also unionizing in order, based on the self-consciousness, has a huge relation to what Lise was talking about a self-regulated system. Mm-hmm. So I think it was great that you managed to come and contribute a little bit. But since we've been talking for like over an hour and a half, maybe whoever's here would like to have questions for anybody. In the meantime, I wanted to thank everybody for the presentations and open up to the floor.
Thank you for that. It was really, really interesting series of presentations. It was just a question about whether, it was something I detected in a number of the presentations, it was certainly mentioned at one point, whether it's perhaps valuable to actually disentangle claims about the sort of dignity of work, which I think was mentioned at one point, from actually claims or rights to fair pay. And whether actually that might actually be quite important, because I wonder, there's a lot of work that's not dignified in any way, and I think that kind of claim actually could be quite dangerous to make in this context. And whether actually really this is all about remuneration and pay, which is a slightly different set of aims, perhaps. I just wonder whether you may want to reflect on that or answer that. Thank you.
Annie and Lisa also are online. You can answer if you feel like it.
I can relate this question to the question of internship, whether internship should exist at the first place. And it's maybe, I'm not sure whether it's so much about dignity of work, but just dignity in your workplace, you know? So I think there's a difference there. I agree. And actually, like, I myself am involved in some other forms of labor organizing that at times I think the work itself should be abolished. But I think in a scheme of the word dignity, I think it's always going to be important. And I don't think there's any space in any movement where dignity is out of the struggle and out of the equation, you know. And I actually, this is not quite directly related, but I just want to say the idea of self-regulation. Who are self here, you know, like, and this is when I think identification of ourselves are really important, right? Are artists self-regulating? Are institutions self-regulating? Are we regulating institutions? To, you know, are art workers self-regulating? You know, I think I don't have an answer, but I want to bring out some of the nuance on the language of what does, you know, what does dignity mean to the difference between asking for dignity in your workplace or in your community versus regulation, you know, and who are the selves, who constitutes the selves here?
Yeah, I think we had quite similar thoughts to that as well. Like, you know, do we actually want internships, or is this what we're asking for? And I think what we had experienced in our campaign is that, no, we don't want internships, we want jobs, you know? And there used to be training at the job and, you know, learning is part of the process. So this is, you know, it's actually not a dignified work to be an intern. Why being an intern in the first place? You know, you're a worker and you should be titled as a worker, you know? I mean, you know, best in terms of a core, but at least, you know, be part of the team and not just sort of like the intern. So I think dignity comes in, but I think the other question, which how we define ourselves, which we were thinking a lot about, is what's actually the difference between unpaid labor in an institution and unpaid labor we do, for example, for the Precarious Workers Brigade, you know, every day. Or, I mean, I'm sure everyone in the room, correct me if I'm wrong, has worked unpaid for a number of things, you know, and how do we define ourselves as activists, as volunteers, where are the boundaries, what's the difference, you know? So I think this is, for us, an important question.
Do you mind if I just say one more thing in terms of work, you know, and internship? So one of the kind of key legal terms that define an internship is that the internship, at least, you know, by law here, is that it has to be a learning opportunity. You know, you have to be learning. So interestingly, our group in the very early years when we were formed, we went to an organizing kind of teach-in that was held by, you know, kind of seasoned labor organizers. And they talked about a worker's right. And part of the right in work is that work should not, work without learning opportunity is slavery. You know, like, why do we think that if we work, then there's no learning opportunity within work? Why is there, if we work, then it's you know, there cannot be art, or, you know, that's a separate thing. And I think that continues to be a very fundamental question that I have as I get involved in this struggle. And I think in our group, and now we're getting to a point when we're ready to start asking whether internship should exist and what's the difference between internship and workplace, right? Why does internship has a specific kind of set of terms that's different than workplace, you know? So does that mean, like, if internship supposedly is a learning opportunity, then does that mean work, our work, we're not supposed to be learning, and therefore the compensation is what makes it okay that in work we do not learn? So there's these terms that, you know, really continue to kind of get examined in this way that it might not be resolved by, you know, legal terms.
I think there's another question. Yeah.
Oh, God.
Me?
I must be a bit simple because, you know, my understanding of work is it's something that you do, it's a function that you do, that an organisation or a company employs you to do, that you depend on to live, and therefore you should be paid. I mean, it's a no-brainer, all this talk, all this... I mean, I'm a socialist. I'm in a socialist... and there's all these fragmented groups. I mean, on the way here, I cycled by Tusk, Trade Union and Socialist Coalition. And all I ever hear, all I hear is all this talk. And it's a no-brainer. If you work, you should be paid for working. If you're contributing to an organisation and you're doing a function that I presume needs to be done, otherwise, why are you doing it? Then therefore you should get paid, because that's what puts food on your table, pays your mortgage and allows you to live. And we're told we live in a capitalist world, a market economy. That's what we're told. You sell stuff, people buy it off you. Your labour is what most of us, people like working class people like me, depend on to live. All we've got to do is sell our labour. So all this wank talk is, it gets on my nerves because it's all wasting time. And I hear it at the socialist organisations that I go to, there's a lot of talk and no action. And it seems to me, unless I'm crackers, but it's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
It really is a no-brainer.
But there was a lot of action in the presentations that were...
Yeah, but I mean, they're like the
person... Yeah, but anyway, I just wanted
one
to...
One last comment. The person who's on the screen at the moment, she said that there's a law, that it's against the law.
Yeah.
Unless I got it wrong. Yeah. So why isn't the law being applied? If the law exists, why are these people flouting the law? And why are they... How are they getting away with it?
Yeah.
Surely legal pressure can be brought to bear. I don't know.
Yeah, I think this deserves an answer.
I think
like, does anybody want to comment on?
I would also like to say it's beyond.
Hello.
So yeah, we have to be very, we have to try to speak to the mic and also try to speak one after the other, because otherwise with the Skype, it becomes a bit difficult. So I would ask, Rachel, did you want to say something about?
I think it's important to think it's beyond internships as well. Mm-hmm. I know this is a really important issue, but it's actual practicing artists that are suffering, especially freelancers. When Universal Credit comes in, for example, so many of us will get screwed over by it because of the way that you have to equate for your living wages. I'm not going to go into Universal Credit right now. But, I mean... There's some information on our website and some of the things that we're gathering basically we wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the fact that we have people coming towards us and saying we want change, we want we want to stand up and say some of the things that we've found out, you know. And it's heartbreaking, some of the things that people are saying to us, you know, ranging from sexism, ageism, disability discrimination, where you want to work, that people have been gallery assistants and don't even make a living wage, let alone be able to fund their own practice. Everything's geared up for a more kind of wealthy kind of person. Mm. And while I don't begrudge anybody, I just think that we've got a social responsibility. It's about human rights. You know, the amount of people that are going to food banks and can't even feed themselves, you know, and then you have the kind of double-edged sword, because then people go, but why should we fund taxpayers' money for arts?
Yeah.
And then...
I'm just going to interrupt you there, because I see that Tatiana might... Tatiana?
Yeah.
I
think we should...
Yeah. Are we going to take another question, or
And I would like to comment on that.
Yeah.
Oh, it's just because I was responding, and then gave you the mic.
Yeah.
You know,
The point is there is a surplus of creative labour. There's lots and lots and lots of people, young people graduating, people who've been at artists for years and years, who are, you know, vying, you know, we can talk about internships and, you know, the fashion and the creative industries and journalism, you know, let alone jobs. But the point is, as you said, Rachel, and as the other person's presentation, artists are working for free. It's not that we've got internships, it's that we're doing work and being commissioned and not being paid for it. You know, we're being expected to fund our own work, you know, our own materials, show our working galleries for free for non-profits, and never get a penny for it. And the point is, you know, it's not that, you know, we're working for free. We're doing 2, 3, 4 jobs. We are working. We're working in, you know, we're subsidising our artwork. That's the point. You know, yeah. It's not just, oh, I'm not getting paid, I'm doing internship. You're not getting paid for that work. You're doing that work for free, and then you're working, you know, God knows where else and whatever else. But yeah, there's a surplus of creative labour, and there's a reason why that, you know, galleries, you know, institutions, etc., can say, "Well, work for free. I've got, you know, 300 people lining up to work for free for us." Yeah. That's what enables this kind of abuse.
Yeah, yeah.
Additionally, it's not just about the fact people are expected to work for free. It's I'm currently working with a national portfolio holder as a new producer, and they didn't get a lot of money. As an NPO, and so as you kind of go from the top, as the kind of distributes to different people's wages, by the time you get to the producers and the artists, you know, the artists are doing a showcase in London, and I love the company, but the fact that their artists are only being paid £300 for a festival that they're working on now, and I'm only getting £500 for, like, basically producing two artists' new work, we have to then go to the Arts Council and try and get a bid in, and it's very competitive. So even people that are being paid and getting support, and, you know, the company I'm working with, you know, are kind of helping me in lots of different ways, and that outweighs, you know, benefit, but I've got bills to pay too.
Yeah.
So it's, yeah.
I wanted to know if the Annie and Lise had something to say. I'm just going to bring you back into the conversation because you're not here. So I can't look at you and say, yeah, do you want to have something to say? Do you?
I wanted to respond. This is quite a while ago now, but the question was posed, when is activism work? And I think you can apply this equation to just about anything, but I think you could ask the same question about art. When is anything work? Something is work when someone is profiting from your labor. You know, I think that's a pretty straightforward rule of thumb. So when you're providing content, you know, even if it's a situation like this, this is probably not a great example because it's an educational institution or and part of a nonprofit institution, I think. But when you're providing content in the form of a panel discussion or a lecture, that nonprofit can then apply for funding on the basis of having of that the kind of content that you provide. So that's a way in which profit is gained in the nonprofit sector. Obviously, it's obvious in the for-profit sector how profit is gained. But I feel like activism is the same thing, and I do think that activism is kind of like the next front line in the same way that the argument has always been made that you should make art for the love of it. Activism, you can make the same argument for activism, and I think it's just as problematic, and especially as you get this collapsing together of art and activism that we touched on earlier, it's even more important that these distinctions are made in that field as well.
Yeah, I agree.
Can I follow up on that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I really like your comment about the question of, like, who profits from it, like activism or art. I think it's not the problem is that it's not just about profit. It's about value. It's about how we value our work, and that's why I was kind of. I think few things that, like in this discussion, that we don't really talk about economy and how we understand economy. And I think it goes back to all those issues of value, of equity, of common ownership, of who gets who owns the capital that's being produced by the events, who owns the capital that's being produced by organizations that we contribute to. Mm-hmm. And that's why I was so happy to see W.A.G.E. engaging in that discussion, which is, I think, it's very prime, it's really, really important to start thinking about that now and start thinking about economy in relation to our social values, economy in relation to how it supports our lives. And I think it's time to kind of reclaim it away from the mainstream discourse and talk about how our bodies live, talk about care, talk about what we are passionate about, and all those things. Mm.
Question.
Yeah, I think apropos to that, I wanted to just ask Annie very briefly, in terms of thinking about economy, something I was struck by, and it tracks back to this question about new vocabularies, is that the slogan is pay your interns. And if I were doing the branding, heaven forbid, I would say pay interns. Why is there this emphasis on possession? That it's someone other, your interns, that should be paid and not interns more generally?
It's a good question. I think that's when you come to the question of who are we regulating, you know? Like, and somehow, I actually, when we developed this language, I had the same question as well. I mean, it's been a couple of years, and I actually was going to say pay our interns, but because we're complicit in the system. On the other hand, I have to say, to be able to call out, and again, I think I really do want to say this is a very personal position in talking about opposition, and I don't think some of my cohorts would speak about it this way, especially on this term. But I think that being able to kind of stand up and call out is an important process. Earlier, I think someone talked about wishing that there were more naming and shaming, which can be a powerful tool. I actually, I had that same feeling before. However, I would say one thing that was really important with our group that was able to create is a safe place for interns to give grievances. So our weekly meetings was powerful, even though maybe the most invisible thing that we have done. And in a way, we didn't really get anybody to organize their own workplace because the structure is so difficult. But we created safe, stable place for folks to come and meet with us and get resource to tell stories, and they leave.
Right.
That's it.
Right. So you're saying that was a space of kind of opposition that was generative?
Yes.
Question.
Yeah, if no one else has one, I'll ask one, which is just to do with the sort of two aspects of the organizing practices that we've heard about tonight, and the one being about winning a particular issue, like the internship. And I have to say, you know, the trajectory around this is quite incredible for me, having been a founder of the Carrot Workers Collective a number of years ago when no one would talk about internships, no one. Art students would leave the room when we brought it up, cultural managers would leave the room, nobody wanted to talk about it. And to see the trajectory of a number of groups kind of working together and changing that. So I think, you know, there was a very stated aim around all of those groups taking on a single issue and trying to work it and win. And then on the other hand, always knowing that that was never going to be sufficient because we actually hated the industry. You know, we fundamentally hated the way it was organized. We hated the values it had adopted around corporatization, privatization, and that's become worse. And so, you know, it's interesting tonight to hear a lot more about creating new institutions, whether it's wage, you know, creating an institution that actually can pay its own worker or workers, or the cooperative model. But I also wonder about within the different kinds of cultural institutions, if it's possible to wage a kind of movement around the organization, around the distribution of resources, around the hierarchies, around who's on boards of directors, and these kinds of questions. I'm just wondering about people's thoughts on that as a kind of a new forefront for these kinds of organizing practices.
I think Lise should answer this question.
I'm sorry, I'm just not sure if I completely understood. You mean
creating institutions of our own, and then how do we... would you mind just repeating the last part so I can just make sure that I answer correctly?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think one is about the experience of self-organizing and creating sort of sustainable structures for doing so, and the other is then how does that start to push at changing the very nature of the organizations, particularly in the cultural sector, but other sectors as well. Or is, you know, it's a kind of question, I guess, to some extent, around autonomy versus institutions. What do we learn from autonomy, but how can that spread and be pushed into other kinds of more mainstream institutions, whether maintaining positions outside is always the way, you know, I don't know, sort of related to that.
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think I touched on it in my incredibly truncated presentation, the way in which WAGE needs to both work with institutions and against them at the same time. And I also talked about, obviously, about making WAGE sustainable through needing funding. I think that's just critical. But the last part of it, and this is, you know, kind of early days to talk about this possibility, but we're thinking about trying to extend WAGE certification, which is the certification of institutions, which I didn't really get to talk about too clearly, or I didn't finish discussing it, but so I hope this will make sense, but the idea that we might start certifying individual artists. So that would entail artists committing to only exhibiting with WAGE certified institutions, or committing to only exhibiting or doing programs with institutions that will pay them according to our standards. So I'm bringing this up because what's interesting about it is that it can extend beyond artists and institutions. It can extend into the payment of art handlers or custodial work, you know, people who might potentially be in nascent union formations already, so that we would, the institution, that person or that kind of node, whether it's like a single person or an organization, could use their certification as a point of leverage to acquire a higher wage or to as work refusal. So it's a kind of a hybrid boycott union model that we're thinking about right now. So that's a way in which, because I think it's really critical, I mean, I tried to talk about this in my presentation, that we extend beyond just the payment of artist fees, even though that's WAGE's really specific remit. And it's because of that myopic focus that we've been able to, I think, sustain ourselves for this long. But for example, within WAGE certification, we could have made it a condition that we would only certify organizations that didn't have unpaid internship programs.
Nice.
And that got voted down at our summit, but it's something that I think we need to think to rethink, because it's as you've seen tonight, I think it's so important. So I hope that answers the question in some way.
I think so. Are there any other questions?
I wanted to follow up on Jana's question, because I find it really, really exciting. I mean, this is the field I'm totally fascinated with at this point, as someone who's trying to create an institution and trying to talk to other people who are creating institutions. I think we could actually be so much more optimistic about the potentials of institutional building that we actually face now in the age of internet and open source share and the possibilities of kind of copying different kinds of very effective institutional models. There are always, like, there are bunches of people internationally who are trying to experiment with that. So, like, you know, things like hack spaces and maker spaces, how they develop their approach and open membership, and usually they don't even stand by like cooperative values, but they operate as cooperatives. So there is a lot of new institutional building happening. It's, I think a lot of it is happening behind the what we can see on the art scene, but I think it's really it can be an exciting field to go into, and there is a lot of optimism in there.
Before you comment, I would ask anybody else if they had another question in order to get people speaking a little and participating a little, if there are. No, they're not. They're okay, go for it.
Thank you. Yeah, I have a question to our friends from Intern Labour Rights, or actually also from the audience, or whoever actually is interested in engaging in this question. My question comes back to the workplace organising, and either as interns or and other forms of precarious work. And I wondered about your interns' happy hours you're having quite successfully, how you actually managed to do the outreach, because for us it's quite difficult, I must say, because the people who know about us usually don't do any internships because they maybe read some stuff and found other great alternatives, which we're happy about. But, you know, it brings us back to the issue, how do we engage with people, you know, who might not so familiar with the topics we have been discussing all evening, and how to actually bring them together in a comfortable space.
I go back to, just very quickly, I would love to actually get audience ideas about this too, because I wouldn't say that, like, that was like a great, like always a great success either. You know what I mean? Like, we have the same outreach problem. We have difficulties in getting, you know, critical mass often. We are a very small group that look really big. But I would say this. I think our weekly meeting were spaces where we gave space for any stranger, anybody, to come in to get resources. And then our happy hour is a social, you know. So it's this thing where, like, yeah, we're having a drink. And so I think they kind of actually go hand in hand, because inevitably our weekly meetings also become work meetings, you know. So there's this point where at some point we have to get to the work, while the open social is an open social space where, and there's something also about being in public together and meeting. Also give a space of kind of conversation. But in terms of outreach, I think it's always been within our network, and our network gets to grow because we are present in a weekly basis. And I'm not saying that we should start having weekly meetings. That's not what it is. But I think there's something about the consistency of being physically present to have that conversation is really useful.
Marcia.
Yeah, I was just mulling over Jana's question and then thinking about Tanya's response. And I am really excited about the new institutionalism, but I guess I also want us to fight for our public institutions and ensure that they're preserved, because they were so hard won and now we're losing them. And I think what for me is really exciting, when you see public institutions who are hosting networks, because that seems to be really crucial in terms of distribution of resources and creating solidarities. And something that for me, I guess, I work at a large arts university, that is exciting to see at the level of sort of bureaucracy is, well, let me put it differently, that the staff is increasingly insistent on care. Like, they're saying, we have to care for each other, because if we don't, we're going to burn out. And this is no longer acceptable. So there's a much more sort of affective recognition of what sustainability entails, and that for me is it's early days, but there's something there that I just feel like the whole process of insisting on rehumanizing this thing called personnel seems really obvious, but it's really, really important, and refusing the abstractions that we find big institutions attempt to make, and then the result is really detrimental.
Oh, there's a question. I know. Should I give you the... Oh, no. There's a mic. It's here.
Hey, I wanted to ask something which somehow confuses me in this discussion, is that there seems to be a lot of talking about wage, of course, which is a really good thing, unpaid labor. But what I'm somehow lacking is talk on what after when we have been paid, because this is like, you know, well, there we have this huge history of labor fights, and I wanted to ask all the groups, like, do notions such as basic income or shorter labor weeks or something like this, like something that can be thought after people get paid, that surely the struggle doesn't end to the point that all unpaid labor would be lost, even though this would be wonderful somehow, almost feel like utopia, but nevertheless.
Mm-hmm. I only caught a little bit of that, the last little bit, but I would urge people to go on the Artists Union website. We have actually been independently collecting artists' views on their rates of pay and treatment. So if you kind of go on that, it ends tomorrow and we're collectively putting the data together. So we've done an outline already in kind of responding to the Scottish Artists Union. So looking at things like research and development should be paid for the fact that artists maybe might want to have a pension scheme or have some way of like having some sort of sustainability for their future. So these are the things that, you know, I can only talk on some of the things that I know just from attending the meeting. As I say, I'm really new to the Artists Union, but there is, we have been responding to artists that have contacted us already about this whole kind of value system that's a bigger entity that some parts of society don't value arts, therefore sometimes artists don't end up valuing themselves, so they find it difficult to not only ask for payment but all the other kind of support systems that they have. I mean, Nottingham's really, really lucky. We've got some great independent artist galleries, and people can get their kind of like bits of training in there and get on the ladder, so to speak. But it's when you get to a certain level. I mean, I've just done an MA, not that it means anything, it's just a piece of paper, really, if you think about it in certain respects.
So I would actually, if there aren't any more questions and about this, I would actually kind of close this this event with the contact of Artists Union, especially in Nottingham. And I wanted to thank everybody for coming out, and I wanted to thank especially all the speakers, Rachel, Vera, Tatiana, Marsha, and our American contingency as well, Annie and Lise, and it was really great, and this is just the beginning of a discussion that should continue. So please get in contact with all of them, and with the ones that are here in the UK, and download the certification. Nottingham Contemporary should download the certification. So really, thanks for coming and thanks for contributing.
Yeah, it does seem like there's a chance they could actually go for that.
Yeah,
I was very, very surprised. I was making sure, like, when we go here, like, how we have to be, like, you have to be confident at where we're going to, and it sounds great. Yeah. There's actually some job opportunities, I think, now. Yeah. So it's like, well, maybe I just move.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Like, paid jobs.
Thank you so much for bringing us together. It's wonderful to be in the same space with you guys.
Different kind of being
struggle.
In the same space.
Really, no. Yeah, that's what it takes. You know?
Right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you.